Good morning, students, and welcome to the digital class of social studies of class 7 on the behalf of St. Paul Senior Secondary School, Eton. Today we will continue the second chapter of the history, that is the Mughal period, and today we are going to discuss about the next Mughal emperor, that is Shah. Okay, the reign of the Shah, the period of the rule of the Shah was 1627 to 1650. Okay, as we all know that Nur Jahan was a stepmother of Shah Jahan, which was known as Prince Khurram also. Nur Jahan, actually she wanted Shahryar Khan, which was his son-in-law. Nur Jahan wanted that Shahryar Khan should sit on the throne of Delhi, and for that she wanted to keep away. She wanted to keep away Khurram or Shah Jahan from the throne of Delhi. Now for that purpose she plotted certain conspiracies also against Shah Jahan, but anyway she did not succeed. Okay, finally Shahryar Khan was murdered by Prince Khurram, and after murdering Shahryar Khan, he sat on the throne of Delhi, and with the title of Shah. Okay, and after sitting on the throne of Delhi, Shah Jahan took all the political powers of Nur Jahan, and she was forced to live a retired life. And finally in 1645, Nur Jahan died. Okay, so this is how Shah Jahan became the ruler of Delhi. Now let us talk about the conquest of Shah Jahan. Like other Mughal rulers, like his predecessors, Shah Jahan also wanted to expand his territories. He also wanted to expand the territories of the Mughal Empire. And now for that purpose, to achieve this aim, he first started from the Deccan side. And he conquered some of the Deccan cities such as Ahmednagar, okay, then Gilgit, then Golconda, and then Bijapur. Firstly, he attacked on the Ahmednagar in 1633. To win Ahmednagar or to conquer Ahmednagar, he sent Bahawat Khan. He sent a big Mughal army with under the leadership of Bahawat Khan. Then a battle took place between the ruler of Ahmednagar and Bahawat Khan, in which the ruler of Ahmednagar was defeated, and finally Ahmednagar was merged into the territories of Mughal Empire. Okay, after that a farman was sent to the ruler of Golconda, in which he was asked to accept the sovereignty of the Mughal Empire. When the ruler of Golconda he received that farman, he readily accepted the supremacy or the sovereignty of the Mughal Empire. He just not only accepted the sovereignty of Mughal Empire, but he was ready to read Khutba, and he also became ready to run the points which were engraved by the pictures of Shah Jahan, and he also paid a sum of rupees 128 lakhs as an area of annual tribute to the Mughal Empire. Is it okay? So this is how Golconda also became a dominant part of Mughal Empire. Now in 1638, the Mughal army turned against Bijapur, and at that time the Sultan of the Bijapur was Adil Shah. Then a battle took place between the Mughal army and the Sultan Adil Shah, in which the ruler of the Bijapur was defeated, and he was then after that defeat, Adil Shah actually accepted the supremacy of the Mughal Empire, and he just not accepted the supremacy of the Mughal Empire, but he also paid a sum of his 20 lakh as a tribute to the Mughal Empire. Okay, after that, after this, for next 20 years, Shah Jahan did not send any kind of expedition to Golconda and Bijapur. Okay, so this was all the concept of the about the dental canker of shark. So let us talk about the canker of the Central Asiatic campaign. The Central Asiatic campaign by shark. Actually, you know, it was a very serious, you know, dream of Shah. You know, he wanted to win the province of Balkan Bokhara. He wanted to win the province of Balkan Bokhara, which was located in the Central Asia. You know, at that time the chief rulers of the Balkan and Bokhara, they were busy in fighting with each other. And you know, one of the chief ruler, whose name was Nagar Mohammad, he asked help from Shahjahan. Shahjahan, you know, was curiously waiting for that, and he saw this event as an opportunity for him. Okay, so taking this as an opportunity, Shahjahan sent his son Murad along with Ali Mardan Khan to Balkan Bokhara. Now, you know, when the Mughal army of Shahjahan reached to Balkan Bokhara, who is the Balkan Bokhara, the region of the ruler of the Balkan, okay, he fled away. He ran away from Balkan Bokhara, and after that, Murad, he did not want to stay. He did not want to stay over there, and he returned to Delhi. And when he returned to Delhi, Shahjahan sent another expedition to Balkan. And when Shahjahan sent another expedition to Balkan, you know, now this time the Mughal army has to face trouble from both the sides. Both the sides means from the side of Uzbeks and other tribes. The army of the, you know, the forces of the Uzbeks and other tribes, they were forcing the army of the Mughal Empire, okay, to retreat back to India. Finally, the Mughal army did not succeed to have a control or to establish their control over the Balkan Bokhara, and this was a huge blow in the prestige of Shahjahan. Okay, so the next campaign was against the Kandahar. Now, you know, Kandahar was a territory of the Mughal Empire at the time of Akbar, but during the time of Jahangir, okay, Kandahar was lost by him. But, you know, it was a deep desire of the Shahjahan to have a, you know, to conquer the fort of Kandahar. Okay, to conquer the fort of Kandahar. Now, at that time, the governor of the Kandahar was Ali Mardan Khan. And he was not having good relations with the master of Hira. Okay, so, you know, so what he did? He just handed over Kandahar to the Mughal army, to the Shahjahan, and he himself took shelter into the Mughal court. But another ruler of Iran, that is Shah Abbas II, with much preparation, fight against the Mughal army in 1648. Fought against the Mughal army in 1648, and after that battle, okay, the Mughal army lost Kandahar because the Mughal army was defeated. And finally, you know, it was conquered by Shah Abbas II. After this, Shahjahan made three expeditions. That is in 1649, in 1642, and 1658 to conquer Kandahar. But you know, he could not succeed, and he lost Kandahar for forever. Okay, so these were the campaigns of Shahjahan to extend the Mughal Empire. Okay, now. Let us discuss another topic, that is Shahjahan rule, a magnificent golden age. Shahjahan's rule is also considered as a golden age of the Mughal period. Why? Because of the, you know, various reasons. For example, you know, during the Shahjahan rule, peace and prosperity was there, and you know, Shahjahan constructed many buildings and monuments during this period. such as Taj Mahal and Fort Canning, Jama Masjid, not only you know to Agra and Delhi but also to the other parts of India. Okay, you know Shah Jahan also adorned. He also adorned you know Kohinoor diamond and Peacock throne. Okay, Kohinoor diamond actually it was given as a gift by the Rajput rulers to Humayun. It was given by the Rajput rulers to Humayun and during his early rule. Okay, the next thing for which the period of the Shah Jahan was known as the golden age was that during the time of Shah Jahan, you know, there was the flourishment in many fields. For example, you know, the field of architecture, the field of literature, the field of dancing, music, culture. Okay, they were flourished in a very better manner. So because of these reasons, Shah Jahan rules, it was also known as the golden age. It was also known as the golden age. Now let us talk about the relation of the Shah Jahan with his four sons. Shah Jahan actually he was having four sons. Okay, they were Dara Shikoh, then you know Murad, then Aurangzeb and Shuja. Okay, these were the four sons of Shah Jahan, and you know these four sons they were very jealous with each other. They were very jealous with each other because each of his son wanted to sit on the throne of Delhi. Okay, he allotted different provinces to all of his sons. For example, he made Dara Shikoh the governor of the Punjab and the Western India. Okay, and his second son Shuja, he made him governor of the Deccan region, and you know Murad was made the governor of Gujarat. Okay, you know, and all of his son was having equal army, so that is why you know they could fight with each other with equal resistance. Okay, so these were the religions of the Shah Jahan and his sons. Okay, it was you know very much complicated actually. Now let us talk about the War of Succession. So you know what happened in 1657. Okay, during 1657, Shah Jahan got it. You know he got very ill. He became very ill. But the news of illness of Shah Jahan, but the news of illness of Shah Jahan was suppressed by Dara Shikoh, who was living with Shah Jahan at that time. He did not want that his other brothers, Aurangzeb, Murad and Shuja should know about the illness of Shah Jahan. But anyhow, the news spread and it reached to all of his brothers. Finally, you know, all of his brothers came to Shah Jahan and a war of succession started. And a war of succession started between all of the sons of Shah Jahan. Okay, then in that war of succession, Aurangzeb became victorious, and after killing all his brothers, he occupied the throne of Delhi. Okay, then when he sat on the throne of the Delhi, he declared himself as the emperor of as the next Mughal emperor, and the Mughal emperor of not only of Delhi but of the India. Okay, and after that he just killed all his enemies. Okay, all the claimants of the throne. Okay, if we talk about the brother Dara, of his brother Dara Shikoh, he first defeated Dara Shikoh at Dharmad and then at Samugad. But from Samugad he evaded. Okay, he ran away from there. Shah Jahan, after becoming the emperor, he made very huge search for Dara Shikoh, and at the end Dara Shikoh was caught and he was reduced before the Aurangzeb, and finally he was murdered brutally. Okay, when Aurangzeb sat on the throne of Delhi, he made a search for Dara Shikoh, and when he was caught, he was reduced before the Aurangzeb and he was murdered brutally. Finally, Shah Jahan died in 1666. But his rule came to an end in 1658 only, when his throne was occupied by one of his son, Orange. Okay, so this is the whole story about Shah Jahan.